We start our journey by getting on a plane in Shanghai and traveling to the other side of the planet. Our destination? Chile, South America. Chile is sometimes called the country at the end of the world. There are those who believe the name derives from a bird whose call sounds like the word. A far more likely explanation is that the name comes from the Inca language, meaning quite simply, the country in the south. It is a land full of contrasts, where nature and spectacular scenery continue to rule. It's bordered by the Pacific Ocean on the west and isolated from the rest of South America by the Andes Mountains. Chile stretches over 4,300 kilometers from north to south, but is only 350 kilometers at its widest point east to west.
Chile encompasses a remarkable variety of climates and landscapes. Within its borders are the world's driest desert, lush expanses of forest, a spectacular array of glaciers and fjords, as well as islands of unmatched beauty.
Chile also enjoys a rich and varied cuisine. It's a producer of excellent food products which are shipped far and wide. Of course, there are few places on the planet not familiar with Chilean wines, which continue to expand and improve, rapidly becoming some of the world's finest.
The traditional hospitality of Chileans, well documented by travelers since the 18th century, is even more evident today.
Santiago is a modern metropolis with gleaming office tower blocks and high-speed freeways. It is the center of activity and the country's transportation hub. The city enjoys growing theater and restaurant scenes, dozens of shopping centers, and a rising skyline, including the tallest building in Latin America, the Gran Torre Santiago. Rising immediately alongside the city, the Andes Mountains are a constant presence, engraving themselves into the minds of the city's residents and visitors.
Hola, bienvenidos a Santiago. Well, welcome to Santiago. We are here at Santa Lucia Hill, and we can see the whole of the city.
Chile has a population of 17 million, 40% of which live in the metropolitan Santiago area, which is located right in the center of the country.
Well, why don't we get down into the city and see it up close and personal?
Santiago may be home to millions of people, but it makes the visitor feel like they're in a small, very manageable city. Leafy avenues, large open public spaces, and well-tended residential neighborhoods create a family atmosphere.
One of the best places to get a view of the city is a climb up the Cerro Santa Lucia, or Santa Lucia Hill. In 1834, Charles Darwin himself wrote of the Santa Lucia Hill as one of his favorite spots, noting its striking views.
But no visit to Santiago could be complete without taking a walk through the famous Mercado Central, or Central Market. Its character is equal to those of the greatest urban markets of Europe. As you stroll through its many aisles of vendors selling anything and everything, from food to furniture, the sheer variety of products will amaze. Chile's fresh fruit is not to be missed if you visit in the spring or summer. The aisles are lined with stalls selling blueberries, plums, strawberries, peaches, apricots, cherries, watermelon, and kiwi. Chile is also famous world over for its delicious avocados.
The market is especially known for all the marisquerias, or fishmongers, who sell what many consider to be some of the best seafood you can buy. Now it is time to say goodbye to this friendly city and begin our journey to visit some of the remarkable landscapes that have made Chile famous throughout the world.
So we hop aboard a comfortable Land Chile flight, which takes us south from the capital all the way to the end of the world, Punta Arenas. From here we will visit the awe-inspiring glaciers and mountains of Patagonia. As we drive from Punta Arenas to Puerto Natales, we have entered a land formed by expansive plains, fierce winds and wilderness. We look out the window and notice a swath of pink color near a lake. We stop and see that it's a flock of flamingos. As we return to the car, a sign reminds us that the road we are traveling on has been aptly named the Road to the End of the Earth.
We arrive in Puerto Natales to find a colorful town on the shores of the Última Esperanza Sound. Today, Puerto Natales caters mostly to tourists and hikers looking to take in the region's breathtaking scenery. The waterfront has incredible vistas and is a lovely place to take a walk. It seems almost impossible to believe that this picturesque and friendly town was once one of the world's busiest ports.
Oh, this is such a beautiful, small, quiet little town here. And it feels like it's the end of the world here at Puerto Natales.
We are literally at the end of the Southern Hemisphere, in a region called Patagonia. Uh-huh. This place used to be bustling because before the Panama Canal was made, all the ships, whether going from east to west or west to east, from the Pacific to the Atlantic, vice versa, had to pass by this place. But nowadays it's more for tourists because look at the region. I mean, beautiful scenery, beautiful nature.
It's absolutely magical. It's spectacular. But I feel like I want to get a little bit closer to it. I want to get up where the glaciers are, up in these mountains. What do you think?
Let's get up close and personal by going on a boat and see it right there.
And I have the perfect boat to go on. Let's go on the Scorpios.
Let's go right there.
We are now getting ready to visit one of the most unspoiled landscapes on the planet. Our goal is to visit Chile's stunningly beautiful glaciers and fjords. And the only way to do this is to travel by boat. We are especially lucky to be sailing on one of the Scorpios luxury cruise ships that offers an experience that is impossible to beat.
Well, here we are at the Scorpios, a fantastic boat. But not only that, we are just surrounded by this spectacular scenery.
With the seaside view that you have in your cabin, you'll see all the scenery every day. Mm-hmm. We'll have beautiful Chilean seafood, lamb, Chilean wine on this beautiful ship, Scorpios 3, because they have three different routes, so they're three different ships.
Okay.
Small ships, attentive to service, attentive to all your needs.
Enough said, let's board.
Let's go. Scorpios ship is an icebreaker that has been converted into a floating luxury hotel. It will most certainly provide wonderful protection against the unpredictable weather outside and the occasional iceberg. right behind me, there's a very special passage. What is it?
Well, actually, it is the narrowest maritime passage in Chile, and it's actually only 80 meters wide, and this boat is 60 meters.
My math is terrible, but that leaves us 20 meters to go through this, right?
Yep, so it's a dangerous pass to go through, but I know that the captain knows exactly what he's doing.
Well, I think we're in good hands, so we don't need to put on our life jacket, and there's no Titanic happening.
Let's hope not.
The Scorpius ships are all owned and operated by a single family, which, like so many others, came to this region generations ago with little or nothing but hope and seeking opportunity. We were very fortunate to have Mimi, the family matriarch, tell us her story. It is the first time she has ever done so on camera.
Yo llevo navegando 40 años. Tengo 6 hijos. Y uno de ellos, el cuarto de mis hijos, es el capitán de este barco, del Scorpius 3. Nosotros comenzamos. Nos casamos en el año 56. Mi marido era pescador. Y de allí nosotros, con lo que se podía, economizamos mucho. Tal vez un poco difíciles, porque eran barcos más chicos. Íbamos con un barquito muy pequeño. Primero íbamos con carga. Y allí comenzamos con 6, 7 pasajeros de turismo. Y después tenemos este, el 3, para 110 pasajeros. Del año 56 hasta esta fecha, solamente hemos hecho la vida trabajando. Tengo que hacerlo porque el viejo se fue hace 3 años y medio y nos dejó esta herencia que se llama trabajo. Dios me ha dado salud, tengo 83 años de edad y todavía soy la cabeza de esta empresa. No es fácil llegar hasta donde yo llegué y llegamos con mis hijos, porque yo hice trabajar a mis niños de muy pequeños. No estoy arrepentida. No me considero una mujer rica. Uno tiene, la riqueza lo lleva adentro. Ojalá la juventud nueva pueda escuchar y decir, a esta edad la señora todavía trabaja y nosotros, ¿por qué no lo podemos hacer igual?
After listening to Mimi's inspiring tale, nothing could prepare us for the moment we cast our eyes upon our first glacier.
I'm currently looking at a sea of ice and the boat is slowly moving through it. It's absolutely incredible. But what is mind-boggling is this glacier behind, the intense blue colour. And it's quite spiritual and it's actually really magical to be here. It's something that I would recommend anyone in their lifetime. You have to not only see it, but experience it for yourself.
These majestic ice walls are truly awe-inspiring and a reminder of nature's incredible power.
Wildlife in the Chilean fjords is varied and abundant. Sea mammals such as seals and sea lions are a common sight in this region. Our guide has told us that several times he has even seen blue whales which migrate to this area in the summer in search of food.
It seems we are a little too late in the season to be able to see any blue whales. But we are certainly not lonely, as we have for company Plenty Tonina, or Chilean dolphins. These fast-moving, playful animals usually swim in small groups and delight in chasing any boat, darting from side to side. Now we get ready to jump on a skiff or smaller boat that will take us onshore, where we will be able to walk directly beneath one of the glaciers.
Heidi, this is an amazing place. I've never been to anywhere on Earth like this, where I'm at the foot of the glacier, where I can actually feel the ice right here behind me.
I know, it's amazing. You know, before we actually saw the glacier from a distance, and you can see the immensity of it. But now we're right here, you can feel the energy, and it just kind of takes over. And actually, I found this ice cube here. Look at this. I mean, you will never find anything as pure as this. Sebastian, who's actually the tour guide for Scorpios. Now, you know, I'm standing here with the glacier behind me, and I've got these sounds of the ice melting and crashing into the water. What sort of changes have you seen over this period, which has really been due to global warming?
Well, you can see, for example, the rock that you can see behind me, we didn't see it at the beginning of this season, so that is a living proof that the ice is melting and that the glacier is actually receding a little bit.
Now we're, you know, coming into the winter, will that mean that the ice will start to be recreated over this rock, or are we just seeing this glacier regressing?
Well, it's actually receding, but during winter it's going to gain a more mass, but not as much as it was many, many years ago. So that is a living proof that it's actually receding. And we don't know how many years we're going to have this, but we hope for many, many years to come.
Although the Patagonian climate has a well-deserved reputation for being harsh, it is a small price to pay for the sheer beauty of the sites that surround us.
So it was actually the Spanish that first came over here and saw the inhabitants of this amazing country. And because their size was so big and their feet were so large, that they actually termed them the Patagonians. Now why? Because pata means foot and gon is actually the enlarged size foot. Hence, we have the Patagonians.
This region was discovered by a Portuguese navigator called Magellan, and hence in this region, in the southern tip of South America, there's the Strait of Magellan, and also the southernmost province in Chile is also called Magellan, Magallanes.
Now we have just been told that the captain has invited us up into the bridge where he will show us how he navigates the ship.
Hello, Captain!
Hello!
Wow, so much equipment here. How do you use it? Can you show me?
Okay.
Yes?
Keep down.
Okay. So, Captain, tell me the basics.
Okay. Este es video sonda, que nos indica la profundidad. Este otro es el radar, que nos indica todo lo que está en superficie. Ese otro equipo que está allá se llama carta electrónica con GPS. Este equipo que está aquí se llama girocompás con piloto automático. Y estos son los mandos del barco full avante, full atrás. Y este es para dirigir el barco.
Ah.
El timón.
Perfecto. Okay.
Okay.
So now.
¿Quieres?
Yeah.
Okay.
Off we go.
Rest assured, the captain made certain the ship was safely on autopilot before he placed me behind the wheel.
Well, we've literally taken a piece of ice from this glacier, put it into a glass and add a little bit of whiskey to it, and it is the perfect way to end this amazing trip here in Patagonia.
So, on to our next destination. Salud. Salud. Now that we have finished our wonderful adventure aboard the Scorpios, we decide to visit a local salmon processing plant we were told was nearby. Chile is famous for its farmed salmon, which over the past 20 years has developed into a major export industry for the country. Salmon is rarely absent from a restaurant menu here, and Chilean salmon is generally considered to have a milder taste than others. We enter the plant and prepare ourselves in order not to contaminate the sanitary conditions by putting on sterilized suits and footwear. One of the factors that sets Chile apart from other salmon farming countries is an abundant supply of pristine water. The southern Patagonia region of Chile, an area that encompasses a long coastline, includes fjords and bays that are fed from pure icy rivers that originate in the Andes Mountains. And this is a very clean factory just off the port, and it will take very short time for it to get packed, not frozen, fly all the way to China where you'll get the freshest Chilean salmon in the supermarket.
Absolutely, and they're producing now 2.8 million per year, but that's going to expand to 4 million.
All these delicious salmon are getting ready to leave Chile and fly to countries all over the world, and perhaps onto your dining room table.
Our next stop requires a 3-hour car ride from Puerto Natales. Our destination is by far one of the most impressive sites in the Chilean south, Torres del Paine National Park. Soon the asphalt highway becomes a dirt road. Around us, we see many flocks of sheep, which are remnants of a sheep farm industry that at the end of the 19th century was one of the largest in the world.
Finally, we arrive at the entrance of the Torres del Paine National Park. All visitors to the park must register at the administration building before entering, where one of the park wardens or guardians will inform the current weather and trail conditions.
Once through the gates, we travel a short distance and get our first glimpse of the mountains, and it is most definitely a sight we will not soon forget. As we gaze upon the snow-capped, twisted pillars of grey granite shooting towards the sky, embraced by billowing clouds, no image seems to better capture the heart and soul of Patagonia.
Torres del Paine lies in the extreme southern end of the Andes Mountains chain. It became a nature reserve in 1959, but only reached its present size in the early 1970s. The uninhabited park is crowded with glaciers, lakes, and gnarled Magellanic trees. It provides some of the most magnificent walking and hiking in the world.
The park itself is full of animals, including guanacos, flamingos, nandu, and condors. Of these, the guanaco is the most ubiquitous.
The friendly guanaco is a camelid native to South America that stands about 1.2 meters high at the shoulder and weighs about 90 kilos. The name guanaco comes from the Quechua word guanacu. Guanacos are one of the largest wild mammal species found in South America. They have only one natural predator, the South American puma. Guanacos, like many of their camelid cousins, were often spit when threatened.
An interesting fact about guanacos: since they usually live at high altitudes, in order to survive the low oxygen levels found at these high altitudes, their blood is rich in red blood cells. In fact, 1 teaspoon of guanaco blood contains about 68 million red blood cells, 4 times that of a human. Here is another curious fact about the guanaco.
See this face? This is not your average face. This is the face of a lady killer. Well, we have here the guanaco, and it's 1 alpha male to nearly 40 females. Pretty exciting stuff. But what's also amazing is that all of the guanaco in the Torres de Paine National Forest are actually completely wild and obviously having quite a bit of fun.
It has not been difficult for us to see guanacos. They are pretty much everywhere, as the park is a protected nature reserve. We also come across many ñandu, or Chilean ostriches, a smaller version of their much larger African cousins. However, we were very lucky to be able to see and film the next and far more elusive resident of Torres del Paine.
Here at the Torres del Paine National Park, behind me on those cliffs, are resting a few condors. A few facts about condors. They're one of the largest birds in the world, with a wingspan that can reach 3 meters. Also, they can probably live up to about 50 years old. Now, for Chile, that's the national bird. It's also on the Chilean national coat of arms. And for the indigenous Indians here, it's a very symbolic bird because the color black and white on the body represents the Andes Mountain for black and glacier and snow for white.
The condor soars with its wings held horizontally and its primary feathers bent upwards at the tips. It flaps its wings on rising from the ground, but after attaining a moderate elevation, it flaps its wings very rarely, relying on thermals to stay aloft. Charles Darwin commented on having watched them for half an hour without once observing a flap of their wings. As we can see here, it prefers to roost on high places from which it can launch without major wing flapping effort, using the heat thermals to aid them in rising in the air.
During our hikes through the park, we also came across many Chilean gauchos. They are perhaps best described as the equivalent of the North American cowboy. Gauchos have a well-deserved reputation of being strong, honest, silent types. They are very proud and can be quite fierce when provoked. Also like the cowboys of the Americas, gauchos were and remain proud and great horse riders. Typically, a gaucho's horse represents most of what he owns in the world.
Bueno, la relación del gaucho con su caballo llega es su compañero del día a día. Desde la mañana en el trabajo, porque con tu caballo sales a caminar, a recorrer tus animales, vuelves en la tarde, le das la comida, en la noche lo guardas a su lugar y es como tu compañero. Esa es tu relación. compañía. Y sobre todo tu transporte, porque él te anda trayendo. Entonces, por lo mismo que uno le dedica tanto cariño a ellos y los cuida para tener un buen caballo. En el gaucho, la tradición del gaucho es la mujer y el caballo. No se cambia.
Gaucho's use of the famous facón, large knife generally tucked into the rear of the gaucho's sash, is legendary. Historically, the facón was typically the only eating instrument that a gaucho carried.
And now we have been invited to a gaucho barbecue, where we can see the gaucho and his facón in action.
This is absolutely spectacular. Let's get into this, shall we?
After a meal, the gaucho often sit together and drink a special tea called yerba mate, a herbal infusion made from the leaves of the yerba tree, a type of holly rich in caffeine and nutrients.
Sadly, our visit to Torres del Paine is coming to an end. As we head back to our rooms at the beautiful Explorer Hotel, located on a lake right in the center of the park, we cannot help but stand and stare for one last time at the incredible sights that surround us. Next, we hop back on a Lanchile flight, which will take us to Santiago. From there, we will embark on a totally different sensory experience and visit Chile's Central Valley and its famous wine region.
Vines and fruit flourish in the temperate climate of this lush, fertile region. Yet, until the late 19th century, the region represented the border of the wild, unconquered southern lands. Winemaking was first established here with the arrival of the Spanish conquistadores, and today, wine is the region's most important activity. Their great and unique selling point, as every Chilean knows, is that the best wines made here are produced from the vines which can trace their ancestry straight back to the cuttings brought over in the middle of the 19th century from Europe. Today, the Chilean wine industry not only combines the best of winemaking history and tradition, but it is also an industry dedicated to becoming more and more sustainable as well as environmentally friendly. For our first stop, we will travel to the family-owned and operated Santa Carolina wineries. They were founded in 1875 and are one of the largest and best-known wineries in Chile. For our visit, we have been invited to a very special place, the historical and original wine cellar. The cellar of Viña Santa Carolina is now a national monument. Andrés Caballero, Santa Carolina's chief winemaker, is our guide.
Son arcos perfectos. Sí. Está la piedra. Y esto es la idea. Yo quiero transformar esto en una biblioteca de vinos.
Ah, qué bien. Some of the original vine stocks are still yielding vintage wine today. A rare feat. credited to Chile's natural geographical protection from the phylloxera plague that has periodically ravaged the vineyards in other parts of the world. How does the geography of Chile influences the character of the wines here?
Oh, that is very important, because in Chile we have the ocean,
yes.
Pacific Ocean, one
That's
side,
right.
The Andes Mountains in the other side,
yes.
The south,
Antarctica,
yeah. And the north we have a desert.
Desert.
So it's isolated from all disease or any phylloxera that they can find.
Yes, so in Chile there has never been a case of phylloxera recently.
Exactly. And that's the reason why in the world disappeared the Carmenere.
Carmenere is perhaps Chile's most emblematic grape. It is a varietal that once produced famous wines in Bordeaux, but unfortunately were destroyed by phylloxera. Prior to this, some grafts were taken to Chile where they could thrive disease-free, and it's the reason why it thrives here today. From Upper Maipú, where Santa Carolina is located, we travel to Viña Tarapacá, located in the center of the Maipú Valley. Originally founded in 1874, at the foothills of the Andes mountain range, Tarapacá is internationally renowned as one of Chile's most historical and traditional wineries. Our tour takes us to the vineyard's Isla de Maipú facility, where a beautiful Tuscan-style manor is at the center of the property. This is the best way to experience and learn about Chilean wines, directly coming to spend a couple of days at this mansion where Tarapacá offers an assortment of activities evolving around wine tourism, lifestyle, and even wedding events.
Oh my goodness, this is just beautiful. It's like we're entering into this magical land.
We're in the Central Valley, a narrow strip of land in the middle of the country, amidst palm trees and beautiful countryside. This is where most of the Chilean wines are made.
And we're incredibly lucky because now we get to go into the vineyards.
The elongated Central Valley, with its unique climate, hot sunny days and cool nights, and a combination of idyllic soil type, mean that the vines can flourish. Since the 1980s, Chile has consistently produced top quality wines that sell well globally. Most recently, Chilean wines have made significant headway in the Chinese market.
So Christian, why are people all over the world crazy for these?
How can you be not crazy about this? Look at this, they have sugar, they have taste, and then in a natural process, very natural, go to wine. It's fermenting, which is also cool. And then you get the wine, the terroir thing, the earthy thing, and you got the alcohol, which is good.
And you know what? You get happy.
Absolutely, yeah? I always say alcohol is good. People, alcohol is good. Yeah.
It is, you know, it's one of the wonderful ways to enjoy yourself with friends, have, you know, something amazing in your
to
mouth.
To share with your wife or your,
whoever.
Why not? Yeah.
So I want to ask you though, wait a second, before you say anything, I've got the, you know, we've got so many different wines, but honestly, what do you do?
Me?
Yeah.
You know what? I'm still trying to understand that. No, but I'm a winemaker.
So you
which is basically
stand on the grapes and
not really me, but there's a whole team. But but basically I decided when it's ready to pick up. I kind of manage the thing with viticulturists.
Do you taste them? Do you come around and
absolutely. We chew the skins and it's ready, okay, send it to the cellar and that's it. It's a super normal, natural process. The wine must be simple. That's very important.
Right.
It must be simple. There's a lot of glamour behind this, a lot of brands, but it's for people. You say that. It's pleasure. It's food.
It's
culture.
It's life.
From Viña Tarapacá, we travel south to Montes Winery in Colchagua Valley. founded by Chilean wine icon Aurelio Montes and partners, in a mere 25 years, Montes has become an international favorite, producing a wide variety of outstanding wines, making them a benchmark for other wineries to follow. Hard work and total focus on quality has led Montes to become one of the most respected wineries in Chile, as they continue pioneering and breaking new grounds in producing quality wines. Opened in December 2004, the Apalta facility has the capacity to hold 2,300,000 liters of wine. The state-of-the-art technology and equipment help Montes produce award-winning vintages. Aurelio Montes is also an ardent believer in feng shui. For example, at the entrance of the winery, a wooden access bridge crosses a small lagoon, where water flows towards the building, symbolizing positive energy flow. And now, Señor Montes will explain another unique and special feature of his winery and its barrel room.
I love music. Maybe it's one of my frustrations. I would love to be a piano player, but I'm a winemaker. I don't have much time to play piano. So I love music. And every time I go to the barrel cellar, to the barrel room, and work with my winemakers, you know, putting all together the blends, assembling the blends, I want to stay forever there. The reason why we play music in the barrel cellar, it's all related to the feng shui. It's all about the energy. It's all about feeling relaxed. It's all about being happy in some way. When you play music in a barrel room, it's a place where you want to stay, where you want to work, you do things better. For us, it's a very important part of the feng shui that we follow.
For our next and final stop, we get on our Land Chile flight and begin a 2,300-mile journey from Santiago to the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Our destination is a place that has been shrouded in mystery for centuries. It is an island that has baffled everyone who visited its isolated shores. It's a place that to this day leaves an indelible mark on the human consciousness. The first inhabitants of this island called their home Tupito o Tehenwa, or Navel of the World. And if you gaze down into one of the island's three volcanic craters, it's easy to see why. This tiny volcanic island, a mere 164 square kilometers in size, is completely lost in the endless blue of the Pacific Ocean. But somehow, it was home to one of the most extraordinary civilizations the world has ever known.
I'm standing in one of the most mystical, spiritual places in the world. It's the most remote, inhabited island on the planet. Welcome to Easter Island.
There is no doubt that the image most associated with Easter Island, or Rapa Nui as it is now called, are the hundreds of enormous stone statues scattered throughout the island. These giant human forms have endured against the weathering of time. These are the silent guardians of Rapa Nui. These are the Moai. It is estimated that over a period of 500 years, roughly 900 of these statues were elaborately carved with simple stone hand tools from the volcanic rock found in an ancient crater. Although there are many theories, no one really knows for sure how these massive statues were moved and how they came to stand at their sacred sites. How could a culture so completely isolated from the rest of the world accomplish such a feat with only the simplest tools and natural resources? How could they move these many ton monoliths from a single quarry on the side of a volcano and then position them on platforms called ahu throughout the island, some an incredible 11 miles away? There are some things we do know. Originally, the island was covered in trees, and that all of these trees were cut down by the island's inhabitants. One theory states that the statues were somehow placed on sleds and rolled across logs. But when scientists tried to recreate that feat, it only worked on flat terrain, and the moai had to be moved up and down across hills. The Rapa Nui people have a different explanation that has been handed down through their oral history. Behind me, you can see the quarry where they actually carved the moai out of the stone here. But it was how they actually took it here to their platforms. Now we have a fantastic Rapa Nui tour guide from Explorer, Roberto Dial. And tell me, how did the people of Rapa Nui believe that they would take these statues and take them to the places that they were going to put them?
Okay, you know, have many theories of the transport of the moai. That is the reason today was it's a mystery. Yeah, but my ancestors, they believe, yes, our ancestors to move the moai from here, yes, was twisting, yes. They twisting from here to there, yes, they twisting. And including in the moment to twisting, they singing a song.
Oh.
Yeah, look like Mema Ori Ori Tuko Ihu Mehaka Eri Eri Moai. Mema Ori Ori Tuko Ihu Mehaka Eri Eri Moai. They told in that time the Moai walk.
Because from afar, these large stones were coming down the road like this. Uh-huh. That's fabulous. Can it be possible that only with ropes somehow the Rapa Nui people were able to stand these enormous statues upright and rock them across the island for miles like giant refrigerators? But yet again, when modern scientists tried to recreate this method, they were only able to move the statues across flat ground. Perhaps we will never know the truth. So what exactly are the moai? The Rapa Nui explain that a moai represents the ancestor of a particular family or tribe on the island. Each statue was slowly carved out of the rock from a single quarry, a process which must have taken years. Families competed against each other to see who was going to create the most impressive moai. The largest moai on the island lies still unfinished in the quarry. Nicknamed El Gigante, this statue measures an incredible 21 meters in height and weighs over 182 metric tons. Once finished, the moai were slid down the side of the volcano and somehow moved to their individual platforms. They were then raised upright and turned to face away from the ocean in order to gaze back inland. The Rapa Nui explain this is because the moai represent individual ancestors watching over their descendants, functioning as a bridge between the spiritual world and the living. In fact, each moai is positioned at a slightly different angle from the next. This is so each moai can look directly towards his respective home. It turns out that these ceremonial platforms have even more secrets to reveal, as we found out while talking to Paul, one of the park rangers on the island.
Paul, you just taught me something that most people don't know about this moai. Could you share it with us?
Sí. Aparte de ser un altar ceremonial, un culto al padre, también fueron elegido astrológicamente como un reloj de sol. Tongariki es uno de los ajos más grandes que existe dentro de la isla. Hay 270 ajos, plataformas como Tongariki, pero de esas 270, 20 son relojes solares.
So there are actually pictures on the rocks?
Sí, ellos esculpieron en la roca para permanecer en material. Lo que está en la roca son el movimiento del sol. El sol empieza por acá y se va trasladando hasta atrás de Poike. Entonces ellos en la roca colocan los movimientos del sol.
As our next stop to visit on the island, Pau suggests we climb one of the volcanoes to go and see the village of Orongo with its amazing views over the Pacific Ocean. It was from here we learned about an extreme competition the Rapa Nui people held every year. A competition that would be a challenge to even the greatest Olympic athletes of today. We're actually standing on the second largest volcano on the island. And behind me here is the village of Orongo. And it was the only village that was used purely for spiritual purposes. And what we had was the warriors would wait here for the Manutaga bird to come down here and lay an egg here on this island over here. The warriors would wait until that first egg was laid. They would then race and climb straight down the cliff, swim across the water over to the island, grab the egg, and then swim back and climb back up this cliffside. And the first person to get here became the birdman. Pretty amazing stuff, but I have to say, I think I might leave it for the next trip. From Orongo, we climb a little further and reach the rim of the Ranukau volcano, and the scenery is breathtaking. There truly are very few places on Earth where one can witness such a landscape of extraordinary natural beauty. As our next place to visit, Roberto, our friendly guide from Explorer, has told me of a beautiful, secluded beach where we can have a swim in the warm waters that surround the island. I have to say, this sounds like a fantastic idea after all this hiking. As we make our way down to the shores, we're walking on paths made of raw volcanic rock. A very clear reminder of the powerful forces behind how Rapa Nui came to be. Well, Roberto has brought us to this isolated beach, and you can see here behind us all this volcanic rock, and it really helps us understand how this island was formed. So Roberto, can you tell me a bit about this beach?
Okay, this beach, the name is Ovaje. This is one of the beaches of here we maintain in the original state.
Yes? Right.
But you will see in here different kind of fish in this place. Okay, let's go to the water.
Okay, I'm ready. Just as Roberto promised, the waters are warm and wonderful. As I swim over coral reefs and fish, I experience a feeling of utter peace and tranquility. I can only imagine that at the height of their civilization, life on this beautiful island must have been like paradise. The modern world has made its presence felt on Rapa Nui and its residents. There are now daily flights on Lanchile from Santiago, which provides an opportunity for ordinary people the chance to visit a place once accessible to only a handful of lucky adventurers. The islanders of today are friendly and welcoming to the tourists setting foot on their shores, although they are now exposed to cultures and traditions from all over the world. There can be no doubt that the Rapa Nui remain a proud people who are very much interested in preserving their own heritage. During our last night on the island, Roberto took us to see a group of Rapa Nui dancers performing traditional dance ceremonies, which were used as a way to recount stories and legends from generation to generation through the centuries. It was quite an exciting way to end our visit. We've seen some of the most spectacular landscape, eaten and drunk some of the most vibrant foods and wines, and met some of the most beautiful people on this planet. And although this is the end of our trip, I truly believe that part of my heart will be left here, and part of the heart of this country will return with me back to China. And one thing's definite, that the sun will continue to set on this magical land.